The way I look at it is in two parts. As you know, as you mentioned, it's he's looking at the operational side of things, but I think you've said quite a bit on the operational side. You know, just to supplement what you were saying is what we do with a lot of our portfolio companies is, besides, of course, the help that the entrepreneur asks us specifically, we make it a point to spend about a week in a month, you know, just sitting down at his office and talking to him about business, about strategy. So it's more like a, you know, a good sounding board, because a lot of times entrepreneurs also don't come themselves and speak out their mind. So it's a way of going to them, talking to them, and making them feel comfortable about their own businesses, and also trying to see where is it that you can actually evolve and derive value from what they're doing. On the other side is, of course, the market side. You know, when I talk about the market side, I'm talking about finance. So essentially, we guys are in the companies to invest for about 3 to 5 years, and we need to look at an exit post that to make our returns. Essentially, you know, as an investor, I've made 8 investments, and we haven't looked at our agreement since we made the investment, because they're lying in the shelf, and tell them you don't look at them unless things go wrong. So I really want to touch upon the fact of where things go wrong, and really, you know, at the end of the day, those terms are just terms. We as investors essentially come into companies bringing in more capital than the entrepreneur himself has put in. We come in at a significantly higher valuation than what the entrepreneur himself has come in. We do appreciate that you have put in the effort, and you should get due credit for that. But at the end of the day, you know, to be a symbiotic relationship, we have to understand one another. And the entrepreneur also has to understand that here's an investor who's coming in putting significantly more money at a significantly higher valuation for a small stake, where it's a minority stake. He cannot control the company. The control still lies with the entrepreneur. So a lot of the reserved rights that Seema actually spoke about are essentially rights that investors seek to protect their minority interests. It's not to kind of pull you down in any manner or be unreasonable. It's more to say that, look, you know, today you're doing a restaurant business. Tomorrow you don't want to get into, let's say, starting a food processing business. You want to remain in the restaurant business because they've got their own positives and negatives. And as an investor, when I've evaluated your business, I've evaluated it on certain parameters, and that's where I expect the business to really grow. So, I mean, you know, there is a lot of terms, and you want to obviously strike the right deal. But at the end of the day, you have to understand also what is on the investor's mind. Like I mentioned earlier in the introduction, you know, we looked at about, I think, 10% of our total 400, 500 deals have been in the restaurant space. But we haven't actually invested money on a single restaurant business. And I actually want to highlight this more from an operational perspective, because if you are looking to raise money, it could help you to prepare yourselves better when you approach investors like ourselves. Look at the deals that I got. Roughly half of them were deals where I never really understood the business model. I looked at it historically. There were flatline revenue, the flatline profitability, probably negative. And the business plans really showed me a hockey stick going forward, where the revenue curves went straight up like that, and the profitability increased from minus 10% to plus 30%, you know, without knowing where the numbers are coming from. I mean, you looked at their corporate profiles and you saw that there were no more people being added. So who was rolling out those new stores? There was nobody new who was being added to the team. So the point ultimately is, you know, if you are looking at a genuine growth plan, please do your homework well, spend time on it, develop it properly, see what resources you need. Some of them you may not have. That's not a problem. We can help you to get them in addition to the money. So, you know, whether it's people, project teams, whether it's, you know, a franchisee or a franchisor or whatever else you need, we can also help you tie that up. So at the end of the day, if you have the right mindset in terms of getting the investor on board for growth, not for unlocking value, because a lot of deals we see, rejection, I think about 10 of the deals out of the 50 odd we've seen, were crazy valuations.